So I came back from the internship at Battelle through the U.S. Department of Energy, and I bumped into Dan Arnall, who was the president at the time of a college business group called AISEC, AISEC, and he invited me to come to one of their meetings, and I got really interested in participating in that. And Dan and I, of course, had been in high school together on the speech and debate team, but when we got into college, we hadn't really associated much. He was in the journalism program. I was off in the computer science program. We knew a few of the same people, but through ISEC, I started hanging out with Dan, and I showed him the internet, the web for the first time. And he got really excited about it, so excited about it. He went home one night and he created his own web page just by taking some screenshots of a screensaver he had and annotating it with some text. So he built a web page, and I think it was that web page that he then showed to Mike McKeon. My recollection is the very first meeting between yourself, myself, and Dan was in your office at Learfield. They charged us $100 per license per year. So that was for one listener, $100 annual license fee to Real Audio. We could only afford 100 licenses in a bundle, and that capped out our T1 or our internet line anyways, because we didn't have the bandwidth to do more than 100 simultaneous listeners. We had to license the Netscape web server. That was the company internal email server also for a while there, the Netscape email server, Windows NT. And I don't know if you recall that stack of boxes we had back there in the corner in that little room with no windows, but that stack of boxes was our streaming tower. And we got the top of the line Apple Macintosh 9600 computer maxed out with everything we could plug into that. At a pretty significant cost. Macs were really expensive back then. We probably spent 10 grand on that Mac, but it had to sit there in a box for a month because it was so new that the manufacturers for the video cards couldn't actually supply us a video card for that thing. It was the first Mac to actually ship without a video card in it. So we had to sit around and wait. It's $10,000 sitting in a box that we couldn't use. And that was a heck of a lot of money to Dan and I. Streaming technology at that time could only do point to point. One listener streaming an exact data stream back to our server. Whereas modern streaming technology, it's multipoint. One stream out, many, many different listeners. But back then, it was one to one. Everyone was literally getting their own broadcast. What was different about us from every startup company that Dan and I visited over that 3-year period was that we were buttoned down and polished. Outsiders to the whole Silicon Valley thing, and every other company was in garage mode, right? Some of the companies we visited, Mark Cuban's was no different. Just literally, like, instead of desks, doors thrown over folding chairs to make desks. Everything was just kind of thrown together very, very quickly. Only a few companies like Yahoo that had huge IPOs had any big kind of polished, established presence. Everybody else was just crammed into any old little space you could get anywhere. And just, but we were always very polished. At Learfield, when we started the company in Seattle, when we outfitted the office, everything was always very polished. We were always wearing our suits. We were the only ones ever wearing suits, ever. So the first banner ads were starting to come out on the internet, right? And the Internet Advertising Bureau, the IAB, had just been formed, and they had published some standards for banner ads. And I forget how many formats there were, but several. And of course, the big hoopla was, aha, you know, we can track that people can click on these banners, and you'll know whether or not your advertising is effective because we can be certain of whether or not they saw the ad and whether or not they clicked on the ad. The irony is, of course, is that no one's certain about either of those things, even today. No certainty whatsoever. But that was the idea. And Dan and I's idea around AdActive was, wow, well, so the only thing you can know is if they clicked on the ad. That's so binary. Like, what does that really tell you, right? And so we came up with this thing called the SaaS bar, is what we called it, because it gave you a row of emoticons, happy faces, happy, sad, that you could react to the ad. And so this was the like button way before Facebook, right? This was the like button. You could like or unlike the ad. And also there was a little stop sign. You could block the ad to say, hey, I don't want to see that. Block the ad. And then there was an I button that if you clicked on it, it would do a little pop-up. And so you could get more information about the ad. So it was also a rich media ad format. And I wrote the JavaScript working with some of the folks there at Application Methods who we were subletting our office space from. And we licensed the NetGravity ad server. And I was hacking that JavaScript into the NetGravity ad server, which, by the way, the NetGravity ad server was later acquired by DoubleClick and now is called the Google Enterprise Network Server or something. But that's where that origin of that was. And we hacked it in and we went out there and we pitched this to advertiser after advertiser. We went out to General Motors out in Michigan several times. They really liked the concept. We did a proof of concept with GM trucks. They loved the pop-up window. They loved the fact that they get instant feedback. They absolutely loved the block button because they said, oh, if someone doesn't like our ad, then you can just stop it and we don't have to pay to advertise to them anymore. They loved it. The publishers, on the other hand, they were like, what? You're going to let them block our ads? That's our revenue, right? And meanwhile, the ad server itself had no way of actually accounting for these blocked ads. We would actually still serve the ads. And in the reporting, it would seem like we were still serving, but we wouldn't show the ads anymore because we had blocked them. So that was Ad Active in a nutshell. And we developed it and we had a working proof of concept. You could actually load up banner ads, display them on the internet, and it all worked. And this was basically the like button a long 20 years before Facebook. But it was a real roadblock. The publishers didn't like it all. We went to Yahoo. We talked to Yahoo about using the format. We talked to a bunch of different Silicon Valley publishers, Gannett, Knight Ridder. We went to all these folks and they were all pretty tepid about it. The thing that I remember the most about that experience was that Dan and I were traveling all the time, 3 or 4 times a week. I've been to SeaTac more than I've been to my mother's house, right? And everyone would see us. No, I mean, we could just get any meeting that we wanted. We would get it right on the spot. We would just run ourselves crazy going to visit with these folks. But the GM people were the only ones that ever bought in. We did a limited proof of concept thing with them, but we never got anyone to pay for it. The only time we ever got anyone to pay any money at all to our little enterprise was when we got US Robotics folks to pay, I think it was like a $5,000 sponsorship fee to promote 56K modems on some of the sports broadcasts. And we did a big US Robotics tent at one of the tailgater parties that Learfield threw. When we were in the middle of the Iowa caucus and the presidential race, there was a date that we were doing the streaming debate stuff with Kay, and Kay called me up out of nowhere. I happened to be in the office in Jeff City. And she says, I'm going to be live with President Clinton in just a few minutes. He's going to be doing the first ever digital signature on a farm bill. So no president's ever signed a bill electronically before. He's going to be doing this. I'm going to have him on the air. Is there any way you could get us live on the internet? And I said, well, yeah, absolutely. I ran back and talked to, I forget if it was Scott or who I talked to make sure we could get the patch working. We got the patch working. We got on the phone. Kay says, Mr. President, are you there? And he says, yes. And they say, Alan, are you there? And I say, yes. And I say, hello, Mr. President. And then they go and have their interview. And we broadcast it live on the internet. It was short. I don't know, 2 or 3 minutes is all it was. As far as I know, that was the first president to ever even be on the internet. I recall President Clinton even saying something to the effect that, wow, I'm on the internet. That's never happened before. We didn't have any kind of built-in holdbacks. Like there wasn't any ever a time where Dan and I sat down with you or with Clyde or with or Stan Kenigsville when he started coming out to visit us. There was never a time we sat and we said, oh, this is just too difficult. We can't do that. There was never any, we can't do that. Everything seemed possible. It was just a matter of what did we want to try to get done right now? And that was very infectious because, you know, I know a lot of people work in a lot of other industries and that is just not the culture. That is just not how they think. That's not how it operates. It's striking to me even now, sometimes if I go and visit someone working at a, you know, traditional company, And I'm just amazed by the complete oppositeness of the culture. So very, very important, formative. Those 3 years introduced me to a world of kind of entrepreneurship and the sort of Silicon Valley way that now it's the only way I know. It's the only way I've ever known. And when I'm in another environment, it's difficult. It's like speaking another language. We were outside the proximity, right? There's a certain critical mass of social activity that has to happen around people wanting to do this. So we were two or three people there inside Learfield. And yes, we had some enthusiastic support. We even converted some people. But what we didn't have is we didn't have thousands of people surrounding us all the time that were all trying to do the same. They all had that same exact way of thinking. And so we were just born in the wrong place, so to speak. Whereas people like Steve Jobs, if you had taken Steve Jobs and if he had grown up, in St. Louis, there wouldn't have been an Apple computer. There would have been some other company probably that would have been replaced Apple, and maybe the whole world would be different. I can't say. If I want to be successful in this particular industry, how do I do that? Well, first of all, you have to put yourself in luck's way, in luck's path. It can happen to you anywhere. It truly can. I believe that. But the probability of it happening to you is so much greater if you're in the thick of it. Especially as I felt when Dan and I were out visiting all these different internet startup companies, we were so passionate, but our culture was so different from theirs. There was one time in that entire 3 year period that we went to any company with any person wearing suits, and that was art.com in New York. And the person that we met there was wearing a suit, and we went to Leo Burnett, we went to Yahoo, we went to so many different companies. No one ever wore suits. We always wore suits into those meetings. So we wore our cultural difference on our lapels, literally.